got some people who need funding, we've got some middle ground. Well, you're in for a treat, because Corrine, a personal friend of the center, she's been with us since day one. And she's been doing a lot. We were having a conversation about this some time ago. How do you prepare for an exit when you're not even ready for one? Too often that you get into this due diligence process and you lose deals on the table when you're actually at that stage. So she was previously in NASDAQ and is now the CEO of WFF Connect. So check them out. I'm sure she'll give you a nice overview of what they're doing. I'm sure you guys are going to be on your phones at some point tweeting or whatever. If you'd like to tag us at the center, pay it forward for your friends and your community. I'm sure they would appreciate some of the bits of knowledge you're hearing here. And then if we get a really good one, I'll give away a t-shirt at the end. So I'm going to be poking around at Twitter for your feed. How many of us know about the center? First time here? First time? All right, well, welcome. We educate founders and help them run their businesses faster, all for free. That's why our ticket was free. Thanks to all of our awesome partners. That being said, we're stoked to have Corrine Schneider here today, so let's give her a warm welcome and, figure out how to prepare for an exit from day one. Give her a round of applause.
Thank you. Yeah, so just quick background. I used to be the president of the NASDAQ private market, so that's so the center is a nonprofit organization which NASDAQ is a big supporter of. The NASDAQ private market, we were a division of NASDAQ, and so we worked only with private companies before they went public, and then our colleagues on the other side of the aisle, America, they're around the corner right now talking about how to go public, they would take over the relationship after that. Left last year and started WFF Connect, which stands for Women Founders and Funders. So what we do is we help women connect with funding. We're not a broker, we're not a venture capitalist, it's really around the education, and then we have an online tool that allows women worldwide to post information about their company and to get the interest of investors who want to invest in women founded companies. So got my card up here, I've got some stickers, which, you know, Silicon Valley, you gotta have a sticker, so feel free afterwards to take that. But what I'm gonna do today is not talk so much about women founders, but just talk about preparing for an exit. So I've been a serial entrepreneur. I've started my own company. I started an Irish company. I was the CEO of a technology company. I've started nonprofits and for-profits and been on all kinds of boards. So what I'm going to do is talk to you a little bit about what you should do from the very beginning. And I'm not going to talk so much about the IPO because, again, around the corner, they're happy to talk to you about how to prepare for an IPO. But I don't think you're quite there. There's lots of seminars about that. So we're going to talk a little bit more about preparing for acquisition as an exit. But, you know, again, things that you need to do for an acquisition are the same things you need to do for an IPO. So what I'm going to do today is go through a bunch of different things, and I tend to be pretty informal and try to share some stories with you, and then at the very end, happy to talk about anything specific that I might have missed. But I'm going to talk about why this matters now, why we should be talking about it now, creating the right structure for your company, why your board is so important to this. I can't tell you how many people I talk to who say, well, I'm not ready for a board yet. You are ready for a board. If you're sitting in this room, you should be thinking about a board. Provisions that affect your liquidity. So we're going to talk, yeah. I can, yes. I'm sure the center has a way to do that. We'll ask him, call him when he comes back. If not, you give me your card and stuff. Provisions that affect liquidity. So we're going to talk quite a bit about term sheets. And although this is not a term sheet session, I do a separate session on term sheets. We will talk quite a bit about things that in your term sheet could impact you. And why your cap table is so important. What to do if you get an offer to buy. What you should be prepared for. And then some housekeeping items. And I will tell you that in our WFF Connect, in our database where people again can go online, I actually have M&A shops who are looking at companies not to invest in the companies, but literally to buy them. So they want to keep an eye on companies that are out there in a sector that they might be interested in, or perhaps they've made a major investment in a company and they're looking for small companies to buy to roll up into this company. So again, you don't have to be a multi-billion dollar, there's plenty of seats up here if you want to come up here. You don't have to be a multi-billion dollar company. You don't have to have 10 years of history. Sometimes companies can be bought very quickly. If you are in the technology sector, they may want to see that you're actually moving ahead with the technology development, or you've gotten a patent or something like that. If you're in the retail space or the consumer services space, sometimes they just want to take you out. You're causing an issue with pricing, your marketing might be really good. There's lots of reasons why they're going to look at you. So, first of all, so why does this matter? Why should you be thinking about this today? So first of all, like I said, companies are for sale the moment you incorporate them. They just are. So you might even have an idea. You've heard the term aquahire. A lot of companies around here are looking for good teams that are put together. So if you can put a team of 5 great engineers, a product marketing person, a really hot salesperson together, and you're having some problems raising money, but you're actually having some success in areas, there may be someone out there who's interested to scoop you up. And they may not pay you anything for your company. They may just give you all jobs. So don't be that excited if someone calls you right away and says, I want to buy your company. But also, it's a flattering thing that you've come to the attention of the Googles and Facebooks and folks like that. All of these large companies, and even medium-sized companies, have teams that are out there all day long just looking at companies to buy. So it is a way that a large company can actually grow quicker. And nowadays, it is very hard to get new customers, and the quickest, fastest way to get new customers, of course, is to acquire someone else's company who has some customers. So one of the things you want to think about is curb appeal for your company. Just how do you look? How do you look online? Does your website look good? Do you have spelling errors? Do you have nice pictures of your employees? It seems silly, but those are the types of things people are looking at. Because on the surface, they want to make sure that you look like you have your act together, because they are going to start digging very quickly, very deeply, and what they don't want to do is waste their time. They're not really worried about your time, and we're going to talk about your time soon. Legal costs, when you get into this, go real quick and go high real fast. So I'm going to talk a little bit about why it's so important to work with attorneys from the day you think about starting up your company. And we're going to talk about all the traps that you might run into. And one of the things that happens is if a company approaches you about buying you, that's what the lawyers are after. They're going to make a lot of money on a transaction. So they're going to do some work for free for you, hoping that someone will come and buy you, because then the fees go up. Now, just like any other kind of dance that you have in this world, it's not free, and that's where the lawyer's fees go up. And it may not turn out that you get all the way to the altar, but you now are stuck with those legal bills. So one of the things I want to talk about, too, as we go through, is you want to protect yourself so that as you're going through the process, you don't incur higher legal bills than you need. And I would also say, if somebody is approaching you to acquire your company, if you think it's not going to work, cut it off as quick as you can. I've done this many times. I've been involved in selling companies, some private equity, being acquired, all these things. And your ego is probably the most difficult thing for you to manage, because you are just so hoping that it's going to be a really big number, and there'll be a press release, and you can call your family and say, I sold my company. And you sometimes make stupid decisions. And one of them is your whole capital structure can be eaten up by legal bills. So be careful of that. They are also going to suck up your time. So the first thing they do is they come in and they say, we are going to need 900 reports, sliced and diced every possible way. We want to know every customer from the biggest to the smallest. We want to know what your average size customer is. We want to know by country, by zip code, by area code, the date you got them, who sold them. And suddenly you're like, well, wait a minute. Our CRM system can't help us pull that stuff together. And they're going to say, well, we need to see it. And again, back to the legal costs and the curb appeal. Part of it is they want to see, do you know your data? Can you get it for me? And part of it is just going to be time. And part of it is, whatever you give them, you are now representing to them to be true. So if you don't have, let's say, a good CRM system to pull some of these reports together, and you work on Excel and kind of pull together and go, it looks kind of right, you better make sure it's right. Because you are going to be signing documents that say that you're representing that this information is correct, and you're being paid on that. So again, we'll get into it in a moment, things you need to do. So what you are looking for, and why it matters, is you want the maximum exit with the minimum time and cost. And anyone who's been involved in M&A will tell you there's just not a, the word minimum doesn't show up. It's going to be very, very involved. So why this is important to you, and it's really good that you're here today, is that you do want to grow your company, and you want to prepare it to scale. So an investor is going to look at not just you have 100 clients today and I want to buy the 100 clients, but what did you do to take those 100 clients and turn them into 1,000 clients? So looking at how you are scaling is very important in acquisition. What's really important to you, we're going to talk a lot as I'm talking to you, the founders, I'm not talking to the investors, is that you really do want to keep control of your company. And in an acquisition, if you don't have control of your company, you may find yourself selling to somebody you don't want to, at a time you don't want to, at a price you don't want to. I was in a situation with a technology company I ran where we had an offer to sell and we had an offer to invest. And I sat with the board and worked through what we did. Looking back, we probably made the wrong decision, but making sure that you have a seat at the table is very, very important. You do want to have some liquidity options, so we're going to talk about different types of ways that, that companies can get valued and you can get your liquidity. You do want to make sure you're complying with all security, employment, and tax laws. Probably number one reason why a company doesn't get acquired after spending a lot of time is that something pops up. So we're going to talk about contracts, employment agreements, and things like that. But if an acquirer feels like there's something rotten in your company, they are not going to move forward. They do not want to acquire your problems. So it's very important that you make sure that you are complying. And again, back to working with lawyers, we'll talk about that in a moment and how you can do that. And what's important to you as you go through the process, if anybody does approach you, is that you really need to be just very disciplined about your time. Because, like I said, they can ask you for 900 reports a day for the next 7 months. And you, as a CEO or founder or senior management person, can spend all your time running reports for them, and you don't run your company anymore. And then at the end of 9 months, they say, you know, I think we're going to skip or we can't come to an agreement. And now you've suddenly, you're 7 months behind, and your employees are off doing stuff you wish you would have had done, and the product's not where it needs to be, and your funding's starting to dry up, and you didn't go out and do any more fundraising, so now suddenly you need to lay off people. So again, I want to really warn you, this is a double-edged sword. Now, your board. So let's talk a little bit about your board. So I said, you should probably, if you're in this room, be thinking about a board. And if you are going to take someone else's money, you need a board. I have a lot of people that I work with who say, well, I'm going to do things different, or I'm not going to get a board, or it's just going to be me and my co-founder, and that's enough. So if you are incorporating, you do need to think about who is going to manage the corporate governance. So first of all, if you are going to bring in outside investment, the investors will require that they have a representative or more than one on your board. Now, boards are typically uneven numbers. Why? Because there's voting. Just as an aside, if you're an Irish company, which my first company was Irish, if there's a tie, the chairman under Irish law gets to vote twice. So I always thought that the chairman didn't matter. The chairman was just the person who ran the agenda and made sure that meetings started and ended on time. Chairmen are very powerful, especially under Irish law. So you want to have an uneven number of people. Generally, you want to be between 3 and 5 if you're Series A or below. Now, let's say that you've chosen to be 5. When you're putting the board together, the board will decide whether to present to the shareholders that there has been an acquisition offer. So you as a CEO cannot just go to the shareholders and say, oh, someone wants to buy our company for $5 million, how do you feel? You would have to go to your board. The board would have to vote whether or not they want to accept the deal. Now, most of the time, you have a good relationship with your board, so your board knows that that there is some kind of discussions going on. They're probably involved with some of the information. They may be wanting to buy the company. They may be the investor. So one of the things that you want to do with your board is think about the makeup of the board. If you have 4 people on the board other than yourself who have no desire to sell the company, and for you, you're trying to get, let's say, a quick exit or a nice exit, you've probably got the wrong people on your board.
So I would say when you're putting a board together, think about them as, you know, five chairs in a room. And who do you want in each chair? So you want yourself in one chair, so there's one. You may have a co-founder who, of course, wants to be on the board, so now you're at two. And now you've got an investor who's going to write a $1 million check. That person wants to be on the board, so now you're at three. So you've got two people left. Now, the investor, as much as the investor is required by law and has a fiduciary responsibility to all shareholders, legally, it's not what they're going to do. They're responsible to their fund or to their family foundation, to their bank account. So they are always going to think about what's happening with my investment. So you have two spots left. So what you want to think about before you meet the investor is who would I want in those two spots? Because when it comes time for a vote, I want to make sure the vote goes my way. Because maybe I don't want to sell my company. Maybe the investor is going, well, I put in $1 million, I'll get $2 million out. Fantastic, let's get out of here. And you're saying, whoa, 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 we're not even close yet to doing what we thought. Things are going so well. I don't want to sell. So who could you put in those two seats? So what I always say to people when I'm putting a board together is, first of all, think about what you're not good at. If you're not a numbers person, then put in a numbers person in that seat. So go find a big four partner who's retired. If you're not a salesperson, find someone who ran a sales organization. That person, those board seats, are there to help you as the CEO manage the future of the company. But you also want to, one of the things that happens, especially in this area, and I assume most of you are from this area, is that everybody knows everybody. So if I take $1 million from the investor, and I think, oh, this is great, and then I bring on Sue, and Sue's totally independent, she was a big four partner, she totally knows accounting, so glad to have her. Then I found out later that Sue and the investor are actually investing in the mother company. Now, who's Sue gonna vote with? So, as much as, again, we all want to talk about fiduciary responsibility and responsibility to all shareholders, in the boardroom, different things happen. So preparing for an exit means you have to have a board that you can control, that you can influence, that you build, and it helps you in the way that you need help. So if selling the company is important, you might want to get an investment banker. Have them be one of the seats. Try again to see if it's someone you've known for a while, you can trust, and you can say to them, you know, I'm building this company, I think I can go all the way. They always want to hear that. I think I can go all the way. However, if we find that we're not able to reach certain goals, we may want to see who might acquire us. And that might be what we're looking for. And again, investors aren't that upset when they hear that, because what an investor wants is a return on their money. And if that return is in 1 year or in 5 years, not a huge difference, but the sooner they get a return on the money, generally the happier they are. And just, I think everyone knows the statistic around here, about 25% of investments, or about one in four companies, the investment fails and the investment's gone. So investors are always happy when you're one of the three or four that made it. Okay, so create the board, think about that, do it before you start fundraising. Because what happens if you don't is that the fundraiser comes in and the fundraiser goes, I have a perfect person for you. We should bring in Sue. She's great. We love her. She's fantastic. She's going to really help you. You meet Sue. You go, my gosh, could we get someone like this on our board? This is great. And guess what? Sue and the investor live next door to each other and they've just done 20 deals together. Sue is not going to vote with you. So it's really important as a founder to keep control of things. So that's why I say voting matters. Because in the end, we have five people in the room. You only have one vote. You could own 80% of your company. You have one vote in that room about whether to go forward to the shareholders. And once, we'll talk about term sheets and shareholders in a moment. Voting matters. Who is your chairperson matters. I've been through two companies where I started with a fabulous chairperson, great people, smart, supportive, loyal, helped me, did everything great. And then in both cases, something happened to those two people. And I had a new person come in as chairperson. And in both cases, they were the largest investor in my companies. And I thought it didn't matter, and it did matter. And in both cases, I'm obviously not at those companies anymore. So, and both those companies are still going. One decided to sell to private equity, and private equity decided that since we were a technology company, they preferred having a man as the CEO. They were very blatant and very open with me in the boardroom, so that's what they wanted. And the other company decided they wanted to go a different direction, and they wanted to bring in their friends. So, being chairman, who is chairman, is very important. Now, if you get an acquisition, we're talking in a moment how to prepare for it, but if you do get one, you do need to manage your board through the process. So again, important to have really good advisors. You want a good board, but you also really want a good lawyer. And by the way, you never put your lawyer on the board. All the lawyers are out here will say, I'll be on your board, I'll be one of your five. If you fire your lawyer and go to another lawyer, now what? That lawyer's still on your board. So you have to remove them from the board, which may get very difficult. And by the way, that lawyer is representing your largest investor and 10 other investors. So you really need to think about that interaction. So you need to make sure you've got a really good lawyer walking you through the process. Because what you don't want, again, is for it to suck up your time. And what you don't want to have happen is that there's documents that need to be signed that you don't understand. So if there's nothing else that you don't walk out of here other than put five people on your board and make sure you manage that, is make sure that you understand the documents. So one of the reasons at one of my companies that the chairman, the largest investor, became the chairman is because I didn't understand a couple of terms. And I was running an Irish company, I have Irish lawyers, and we all like to think that the Irish speak English just like the Americans speak English, but they use different terms. And the idea of a corporation in Ireland is very different than a corporation here. So when I thought I would be protected, if you run a corporation, there's no way I could be personally liable. In Ireland, you become what's called a warrantor. And I thought, well, that's not a big deal. But when you're a warrantor, you're personally liable for what the corporation is doing. So I was faced with potential legal problems from my investor, and I didn't have a good lawyer who I felt comfortable with saying, what does this word mean? Now, that was kind of a cultural issue, but you can have that as you read term sheets. And we're going to talk about term sheets in a moment, because the term sheet is the recipe for what will happen if an acquisition lands at your doorstep. So the last thing I will say on your board is that you really do need a numbers person. I was so lucky, the technology company I ran, our CFO was fantastic. So we got an offer to sell, a nice letter, very nicely written, big number for the share, you know, this is how much we're gonna, you know, give you for price per share. And we all were excited, it was about 11 o'clock in the morning, and this is our CFO, he looked at it, he goes, you know what, you guys all go to lunch, give me an hour or two, come back, I'll tell you if this is a good deal or not. So we go to lunch, and we're all ordering champagne, and thinking about, you know, big boats we're gonna buy, and we come back from lunch, and our CFO is like, let me tell you why this is a bad deal. And we're like, no, it's impossible, and then he showed us the number. You need someone like that with you. If you're not that person, find that person. So term sheets are so tricky. The investors out there in the world are smarter than all of us, smarter than me, smarter than anybody in this building. They are so good at what they do, and their job is to get the best return for their investors. Their job is not to protect you. So really want you to think about that. Make sure you've got someone, even if they're not on your board, even if they're an employee of yours, that you can go to and say, here's the term sheet. Tell me what this is actually saying. So term sheets, yeah.
One question about the last one. So the CEO, you're still not able to actually hold it. You did get like an offer for saying.
You don't have to, no.
So you don't have to set the board.
No, if you're not publicly traded. So if you're publicly traded, a different world, you know what you need to disclose. But in the private world, someone can come in and give an offer. You have no obligation. You really should have a responsibility to tell the board. If, let's say, the board found out later that you got an offer you didn't tell them, they could fire you. Remember, the board hires and fires you. You know, 80% of your company, the board hires and fires you. So I would be really careful if you didn't tell that. Probably the best thing is to tell the chairman, and have them say, it's a bogus offer, you know, we're not spending any time on it. Same thing if you wanted to acquire companies, you might want to go and say, we're thinking about, you know, this company's for sale, should we buy it? And they say no. I would never just sit on that information alone. Yeah, be careful on that. But I don't think you can be sued over it. I think you just lose your job over it. Or the judgment call. Okay, so term sheets. If you haven't ever seen one, I would Google it this afternoon and go look at what one looks like. There's tons of them out there. So the term sheet is the recipe for your company. For the investment. So a term sheet can mean I'm going to invest in your company, or it can mean I'm going to buy your company. And these are all the terms under which we are going to do the deal. So understanding it, I think it's really important, and I think this last bullet is probably the most important thing. The venture capitalists and the investors, they write them. Most of the time, they come to you with a term sheet. So who do you think they're writing it for? They're not writing it for you. They're writing it for themselves. And they write a dozen of these a week. So again, I'll talk to you about lawyers. There are really good lawyers out there who can pull a term sheet apart and tell you right away, okay, these three things really concern me. The scary thing is they have really pretty names for some of these things. So how many of you have heard the term participating preferred? Okay, some of you. Really dangerous thing. Sounds not bad, right? Participating preferred, you're involved in something. You don't understand what that is, and it's in your term sheet. And you sell for less than the number that's next to the participating preferred, you will get zero. So when I started my company, the first one, I thought, well, 100% of the pie, and I own, let's say, 40% of the pie. So when we sell for $1 million, I would make $400,000, right? That's what you think. Under participating preferred design, they can say that they're investing $3 million in the company, and the participating preferred might be at $10 million. So what that means is, if we don't sell the company for $10 million, I get my $3 million back first, before anybody else gets anything. So you, as the, you can own as many shares as you want, first I get paid. And so if we only sell the company for $1 million, I get the entire $1 million, because we never made it to $10 million. Because if I'm going to invest $3 million, I expect to get $10 million out. If I don't get my $10 million out, I at least want to get back my $3 million. If you completely failed and you only got $1 million, that's all my money. So things like that go into term sheets that you need to be very careful about. Valuation is generally determined at the time of signature. Now I say generally because there's a few things that are happening now in the Valley where it used to be someone would come in and value the company and say, I think the company's worth $5 million today, I'm investing based on a $5 million valuation, a little bit floating out of the sky. There's a little bit of mathematical work they can do to try and figure out if that's true or not. But they're now convertible notes where people are saying, I think this thing's gonna take off in the next year. We have so many conversations we're having. We think we're going to sign some contracts. We're going to hire great people. The patent's pending. All these things in the future are happening. We want you to invest in us for the future. And so the investor says, there's no way in hell that you are worth $5 million today. All those things have to happen. Today, you're worth $1 million. And you say, no way, I'm not worth $1 million. So what a convertible note is where you say, well, I need your investment money to get me to do all these wonderful things. What we will do is, once a year goes by, we will actually see if all those wonderful things happen. So all those things happen in a year, I might be worth $5 million, and your investment will be based on a valuation of $5 million. Or the investor might say, let's see, maybe at the end of the year, actually worth $1.8 million, so now my investment is based on a valuation of $1.8 million. So a convertible note is very popular around here, and note meaning kind of loans. Here in the Silicon Valley, it means I am putting some money in today to help you get where you're going, but at a certain point in time, we are going to reevaluate the valuation of the company, and if you didn't meet certain goals, then the valuation will be discounted. I can tell you, if the convertible note goes way below what they expect, you probably will not get another investment from those investors. So that's why I always tell people to be very careful when you go in and do a pitch meeting, because you can get really excited about the future and where you're going. And I see this every day, because I work with founders every day. They're so sure about the future, which is wonderful, but you have to meet it a bit. So if those things don't happen, you will need those investors again. And by the way, where are they? They're on your board. So you want to make sure that you have credibility. Now, exit scenarios are discussed in the term sheet. So the moment that someone comes to you and says, you know, we really like your company, we'd like to talk to you about that, the first thing you want to do is pull out your term sheet. What does this mean? Do you have a participating preferred? So my company, we had a participating preferred of $35 million. And we had someone who had come with an offer for around $40 million. So by the time we did all the math, we realized that the only person who was going to make money, really, was the investor. And the employees were going to get nothing, and the founders weren't going to get much. So that's a time where you might want to say, look, I think we're kind of going like this. Let's take the $40 million. You know, let's get out. Let's all go do something else. looks good to tell people that we had a successful exit. But if you're doing this, is that the time you really want to be selling? And again, you don't want to go down the path of doing all this work and spending all these legal bills and then saying, you know what, I'm not going to sell now. So understand the exit scenarios, understand what requirements you might have, and understand the organization of the term sheet. So I've been talking a lot about lawyers. So I will tell you, first of all, I wouldn't start a company without having a law firm represent you. And there are great law firms in the Silicon Valley who will represent you with nothing more than a dream, a little bit more than that, and they won't charge you. So what they do is they all have programs. And what they'll do is they'll say, we'll give you $20,000 worth of legal work, and we'll defer the billing until your first financing. So when you make that $1 million, you will turn around and pay us a $20,000 bill, and at that point, you're on the clock. So you're going to start paying us legal fees. So it's the drug dealer model, right? We're going to give you a little taste. We're going to spread it out. We're going to assume we don't need to do a lot of work for you at first because you're a small, tiny company, so don't call them every hour because I'm going to get pissed off. They tell you that you can run through $20,000 in legal bills. But they're there to help you. And then why are they there? To do your transaction. So what is nice is that you will not get the senior partner of the firm to be working with you unless you are an ex-Facebook, ex-Google, ex-Apple employee. But you will get somebody who will come in and they will start to work with you and they will make sure, first of all, that your incorporation paperwork is correct. So another thing to remember is that if you do not incorporate in Delaware and you are looking for an investment or an acquisition, that will hold up the process. Because if you're in the United States and you're not incorporated in Delaware, investors don't want to deal with you. So one of my companies was incorporated in California, and the first thing the investors told us was, we'll be back in 2 months after you're done reincorporating. We're a pretty mature company at that point. We had about 80 shareholders. I had to go get signatures from everybody. I had to pay money to do it. Had to read board meetings. It took a lot of time. So if you haven't incorporated yet, they like Delaware. Talk to a lawyer about why that is. They do protect investors well in Delaware. But it's just kind of the way it is these days. So I would say if you don't know which lawyer or law firms to talk to go to, happy to give you some suggestions. I don't generally give you one. I'll give you three or four. They'll all meet with you. Their job is to find the next Facebook or Google. So what they want to do is understand what you do. Now they all have sectors. So I know a fantastic lawyer who does retail and fashion. So she would be perfect to get involved in a company that does that. I know another one who does a lot of social. So if you're in social, you go there. So you do want a lawyer who kind of understands your sector, because the other nice thing about getting a law firm early, and again, these deferral programs are pretty popular here in the Silicon Valley. Don't go to New York, they don't do it, but here, they know a lot of investors. So what they'll say is, you know what, I've seen this 14 times already, and you can stop with your company because you're one of 14 companies, and so there's someone who's going to be independent to tell you that. Or what they might say is, you know, I know someone who's looking to invest in agricultural robotics. Just in here yesterday, you're doing agricultural robotics, this is exactly what they're looking for. Let me put the two of you together. So lawyers are deal makers in the Silicon Valley, and that's another reason why you want them there. They are supposed to represent you, so as long as you haven't signed an engagement letter with them, they are not representing you. You also want to be careful of what you talk about until you sign an engagement letter. So in the engagement letter, it will say how much they're going to defer, what they're going to charge. I would also negotiate the hourly rates once the deferral program is over, because you don't want to be in a deferral and then be paying $1,000 an hour. So I would say, this is great. Really appreciate you giving me this $20,000 of legal help that I'm going to defer, but I also would really like to know, once we start going, how much is an associate, senior associate, a partner, paralegal? And paralegals are like close to $300 an hour sometimes, so that's expensive for creating your stock certificates. Okay, so term sheets, read them, talk to a lawyer about them, talk to a finance person about them, make sure that you underline every term you don't understand, go online, there's lots of tools that will help explain all the different terms. Every single term that you aren't even 150% sure you understand, look it up. Now, there are governance provisions that are in either the term sheet They could be introduced in the term sheet, or they could be in your corporation documents. For instance, what's pretty traditional if you do go public is that you are going to prefer to common stock on a one-to-one basis, but an investor could negotiate that. So what you're seeing, if you look at Snap and some of these other companies that are going public, I think Blue Apron I just read about is having some of this, is that you may actually have the ratios be different. So in the old days, it was one-to-one. If I had one share of stock, or one share of preferred stock, it would turn into one share of common stock on the public market. Nowadays, you can see that preferred might be 8-to-1. So I will get 8 shares of common stock for every share of common stock that turns into one. When you're granting options to an employee, almost always you're granting common stock. So when I go back to my example where it was a $35 million participating preferred and the offer came in at $40, the investors all hold preferred shares, which means they're first in line. And the employees will all hold common stock, which means they are last in line. And what's even more painful is friends and family generally end up with common stock. So your Aunt B, who wrote you that $25,000 check that got everything started and believed in you, was the first person there and super excited. You've now got a $40 million offer, the $35 million participating preferred, and Aunt B isn't even going to see your $25,000 back. So you really want to think about that when you're looking at these things. The other thing that good investors will do, so let's say you're lucky enough, you did friends and family, Aunt B came through, you got some employees in, you got a little bit of seed money from, let's say, an angel, a neighbor down the street, and now you're ready for Series A. So you're going into the big leagues, to the venture capitalists and the big angel groups, and you're going in for them. And you get a Series A of $1 million, and now you're feeling very professional, and you're ready for Series B, and you're going to go in for $5 million. Well, what these guys are going to do is negotiate what's called an anti-dilution adjustment. So they know that you're on the way, right? Because you've now just gone through a couple of rounds of financing. So the Series C is probably going to be a $20 million round. So if you're at a $5 million round today, and there are investors who say, we're really just Series A investors, we write $1 to $5 million checks, we're going to go above that. They want to protect themselves from dilution. Because if you go out and get a $20 million investment next, they're going to be diluted by that $20 million investment. So what they'll say is, well, we want to protect our $5 million investment. So by investing $5 million, we own 25% of your company. We always want to own 25% of your company. You go out and get $20 million, we still own 20% of your company. We want to protect that. Now, if you're the $20 million investor and you see that, what do you say? I don't think so. So, this is a really tough point for you to negotiate because it'll be hard for you to close that $20 million round when they see that in a Series A round, you allow this anti-dilution part to be there. This is why you need a good lawyer. Because a good lawyer will say, Series A, we can't do this, can't put it in. You know, it's gonna kill these guys down the road. So we're gonna do something else, we're gonna do a ratchet, we're gonna do something so that we'll protect you a little bit, or we're gonna put some of these other fancy terms in here, we're gonna allow you to participate in the Series C when it comes along, and you know, this will be great for you. But those are the types of tricks that you wanna be careful of. Because if you don't protect your own dilution, remember you started, you owned 80% of the company, then you got 60%, now you're down to 3% of your own company because you went out and raised all this investment. So you also want to look for yourself in terms of how much am I being diluted? Because at the end of the day, if you sell your company for $400 million and now you have 3%, is that enough for you? You know how they say, a little piece of a big pie, big piece of a small pie. The other thing to talk about are preemptive rights. Now, I don't get so excited or wound up about preemptive rights. America, I always give on preemptive rights, and I don't like to give on anti-dilution. But preemptive rights just means they get to keep investing in your company. So when you go out for Series C, you have to come to them first and say, we're raising $20 million. You put in five before. You want to be in for another two or three? You want to do the whole 20? The reason why they like this is they like, it's just an option. They like to say, you know, come to us first before you start talking to somebody else. But they also feel that they can negotiate differently with you. So what they're saying then is, we'll write you that check for $2 or $3 million. We already know you. We don't need to do as much due diligence, etc. not going to take as much time. It's good for you, but you get a better price. Because if you have to go out and educate someone else, go through due diligence with someone else, you know, we want a better deal. And again, we'll come back to the anti-dilution.
Excuse me. Does preemptive rights mean that they get to be the lead on a Series C, or are they a follow-on?
Either. They could. It depends how certain. Yeah, and again, it depends how much they're willing to invest. So some people will just say, we just can't, you know, we don't write checks above $2 million. You're looking for a minimum of $5
million. Is there any negative about allowing preemptive rights?
So here's the negative. If you have an investor who has a big concentration of ownership in your company, and let's say they own 20%, but by now being involved in the next round, they suddenly go to 38% of your company, they start to have a bigger and bigger voice. So that's the only thing you want to think about, because now they may say, we want two or three board seats. So the larger they become, the more powerful they become. So there are always people who say, I want to be very careful who's on my cap table. I don't want too many people. I'm actually someone, I like a lot of people on my cap table, because I don't want the concentration of power to be in any, you know, small group. So that would be the only negative. Other than that, you know, again, you're going to have a negotiation that's going to be, they're going to really, you know, put your arm behind your back and say, come on, you know, we know you. Sometimes it's harder to negotiate with a friend, a strategic partner, a board member, you know, it's more intimate. Now, a few things that are terms affecting liquidity. So right of first refusal, I think everyone knows that one. So there are a lot of investors, especially strategic investors. So let's say that Google invests in your company. What they will do is say, we want a right of first refusal, which means you have to come to us and sell your company to us first before anybody else. Now, I used to think that that wasn't a big deal. Like, great, it's all baked in for us. You know, let's say that Target, you're in the retail sector. Target is your biggest strategic investor, and they put in a right of first refusal, and you think that's great. So if someone comes and tries to buy my company, I can turn around to Target and go, you know, am I going to get into a bidding war with them? But what happens is when people see that, they don't like it. So if I am not Target, I look at a right of first refusal and I go, so you're going to go to Target, aren't you? Target's going to come in and I'm going to get into a bidding war. So there's a company kind of like what you are doing over here, and they don't have a right of first refusal with their largest investor. I think I'm going to go talk to them, so I can probably get a bigger deal. And I have found, I've worked with many, many independently wealthy people. They care about, you know, Togo sandwiches versus Subway sandwiches. I mean, they really do know the price difference. So when they're looking at a good deal, they do not overpay. So right of first refusal is very important. Drag along is an interesting idea. And again, some of these terms I just put up, you can look them up when we have time. But drag along is the idea where a large investor might want liquidity from your company without necessarily selling the company. So Google and Intel Ventures are pretty well known for this. They'll invest in your company, and then you're doing great and everything's fine. There's no buyer for your company, but they need to get out. So they need to get out because strategically you're just not fitting where they're going. And so they love your company and they think you're great and they don't want to hurt you, but they want to sell their 25% of ownership. So what a drag along right for an investor can be is that if Google goes out and finds a buyer for their 25%, then all the other shareholders could also potentially also get that same offer. The reason people like it is because Google will probably negotiate something better than EMB. So EMB might want to be offered the same choice. Bad news for you as an owner of the company is that you may get one very large dominant investor that you didn't really pick, because Google Ventures just did a deal with someone and they come back to you, and unless you have the ROFR, the right of first refusal, that the board determines, the deal's going to go through. So a ROFR, yeah. So what people don't understand is that venture capital firms also have a problem. Their problem is they have a lot of money that they need to invest. And just sitting in the bank doesn't help a venture capitalist. They have to deploy that money. Now, they're not just going to blow the money, but they will take a chance on something. Like I said, 25% is about average of failure. They need to put that money to work. So I talk to venture capitalists all the time who say, God, bring us deal flow. Like, we just need deal flow. So that's why they'll take meetings with you. Now, again, you need to be in their sector. You need to be confident. You need to have a good pitch deck. There's a lot of things you need to do. But if you go in for a second or third meeting, they're very interested in you, and they need to spend that money. So I'm not saying that it's that easy, but you have to remember that they have a problem, too. So that's why sometimes I convertible notes are good. Or what they might do is say, I know you're looking for $3 million right now. We're going to give you $1 million. We're going to see in 6 months. These are the challenges that you have ahead of you. And in 6 months, if you've met those numbers, then the other $2 million will be forthcoming. So, but yeah, you need a good lawyer. That's right. Because you want to sit there and go, oh, my bulldog lawyer said I had to do this. But in the background, you're like, totally do it. You know, go for it. But you don't want the investor to know that. Okay, so anyway, some of these terms are going to be in there around liquidity. Do keep in mind you don't have to sell 100% of the company. So something that I spend my day job in is finding liquidity for shareholders of private companies. So there are firms out there like SharesPost and EquityZen who will help find buyers for a group of investors or a set investor. So it doesn't always have to be sell 100% of the company. And it could be you as the founder who needs some liquidity because you've been doing this for 7 years and your kid wants to go to college, you gotta buy a house, you can find a buyer for that portion. But it comes back to the broker, the right of first refusal from the company, and the board makes the decision whether you will be allowed to sell those shares or that portion. Now, I've spent most of my career working in cap tables. As a matter of fact, the two companies I was talking about, we manage companies' equity plans for them. You must start with your cap table day one. If you don't have a clean cap table, an investor will run the other direction. So they want to know that you know who owns your company. So if you do get a good lawyer, they will do it for you. They all have cap table software, paralegals will do it, keep track of it for you. But there's lots of cap table software companies out there. eShares, probably one of the best known, Certant, Solium, happy to give you some names afterwards. True Equity is really inexpensive. So if you only have like 4 shareholders and you're just gonna type it in, even if you put it into an Excel spreadsheet at the beginning, you're okay. But I would get off that Excel spreadsheet as soon as you get anywhere near 8+, 10+ investors. Because what happens with those investors is they all have different requirements. Remember the participating preferred? Maybe they bought a different type of preferred stock. They bought at a different price, the date they bought at, all those things. So the cap table keeps track of who owns your company, including yourself and your co-founders. So the lawyers, again, they will say, listen, we'll take care of your cap table for you. And fast forward to going public. When you go public, the lawyers have to certify that the cap table is correct because you're now going into the public market. They're the ones who have to say, these are indeed the shareholders of this company. It's critical that it's correct. Do not let it slide. It's a little bit like in the old days you used to write very clear with your lawyer. What we've just signed, too early or too late to think about being acquired. So I've had a lot of board members who've told me that, you know, you've got to be in business for at least 3 years. They all have some arbitrary number, you know, at least $10 million of revenue before you can get acquired. So I think you, as the founder, really need to think about this. Why did you start the company? Did you start it because you really believed in what you were doing and you wanted to have a what they call lifestyle company? In other words, you wanted to be your own boss, you want to employ people, you want to do a good job, you want to build something maybe for your children or your grandchildren? Or did you do this because you really just want to turn around, make a quick buck, and go on to the next thing, which is totally fine. But you really need to think about deep inside yourself, why are you doing this? There is also something about being too late. So your technology might be super hot right now, but a year from now, it may not be the hottest thing, or 10 other people do. So, you know, Munchery is a good one to think about. Remember the first ones that came out, did all this delivery, now there's so many delivery types of things. Blue Apron, there's all different kinds of things. So, you know, I don't know if Muntree ever got an acquisition offer, probably, maybe. But if you think about it, is what you are doing, can everybody else replicate your business model? Because if everyone else can replicate it, are they going to be in the business 2 to 3 years doing it cheaper, faster? And I know people go, wow, but our quality is so much better, or our marketing is so much better. Look, if they can replicate what you do, if you don't have a patent, forget about it. By the way, patents are so important. When you're being acquired, if they look and they see you have a patent, fantastic. Even patent pending, which, by the way, patent pending, we have a webinar on our website about getting a patent. It's about $10,000 if you get a decent lawyer to get to file for a patent. Just increases the value of your company. So try to find out what you can patent about what you're doing. We have more patents in the Silicon Valley than anywhere else in the world, so I need a lot of people to figure that out. Okay, so some housekeeping items, and then I'll open up for questions. So, from day one, keep good records. Always keep board minutes, written board minutes, even if it's on a yellow legal pad and handwritten notes, keep good board minutes, type them up. When someone comes to acquire your company, they'll be looking at your board minutes. Have your lawyer review your board minutes. Worst thing that could happen is that you had a board meeting, and I go in and I say, I think we're getting sued, we screwed up, we shouldn't have done this, and someone writes that in the board minutes. And then it all turned out that it was a harmless mistake. But you have now had someone go, oh my God, what were you guys doing, and why would somebody sue? So board minutes are to reflect the decisions that are made in the room. They're not to reflect the conversations that are happening. Make sure you have your cap tables up to speed. Contracts. Employee contracts, client contracts, they need to be signed. So just pulling out contracts isn't helpful if you're going to be acquired. So this is something that I'm always very diligent on from day one. I want people to sign it. And I know people are like, oh, we're friends, we're going to do stuff. No. Need it signed. Need employee contracts signed. They will come in and look to see what the relationship is you have with your employee. And if you have absolutely no relationship with your employee, then it's hard to say, oh, everyone's going to stay around. Buy our company and you'll get these fabulous engineers I've pulled together. Well, they want to know, what exactly is your relationship with them? This is one that I think is really important. If you really are going to build a successful company, start a diligence room from day one. So go in Box or Dropbox or something, and every time you sign a contract, put it in Box. Every time you have board minutes, put it in Box. Every time the bank sends you something, put it in Box. Whatever it is, just keep a copy, it's all there. And then when someone walks in and says, I'm really interested to look at your company, you can say, I have a diligence room all set up. All I need is a non-binding term sheet from you, and I'll be happy to give you access to that. And so keep it organized. There's lots of security controls that you can do in Box, and by the way, use something like that, because what you don't want to do is email all this stuff to somebody who can then email it to someone else. So think of security controls.
How do you feel about that compared to Gust or CommerceSuite?
They're all good, yeah. I try to go cheap, so if you're starting out day one, Box is pretty cheap, or Dropbox, but there are other ones like that. A lot of investment banks now are offering you some nice little ways to do it, so that hopefully you'll turn around when the time is right and hire them to represent you. And put all your corporate documents in there too. So Secretary of State sends you something, or your tax ID number. You'd be amazed how, if you're in the midst of it, they say, we need a copy of your articles of incorporation. You're like, oh, I can't remember where I put it. Just keep them there. You should also keep your budgets, actual versus planned, in there. One thing that buyers will want to see is, what did you budget 3 years ago and what did you actually achieve? So that'll be a very early number. In other words, how realistic are you about what you can actually deliver? So when you tell me that next year is going to be a $20 million year, I'm going to go back and look and say, well, when you said it was a $2 million year, was it really a $2 million year, or was it really $300,000 a year? In other words, I get an idea of who you are. Start using financial reporting software as soon as you can. So that might be a NetSuite, an Oracle, a Salesforce, both CRM and financial reporting software. There's a great firm, Creative Solutions, that you can outsource all your financial reporting to. They're inexpensive, kind of like the law firms, They'll put you right on, I think they put you on NetSuite, although I'm not sure, but you're right on some kind of technology so that you're not in, in an Excel spreadsheet. And when they start asking you reports, these packages will spit it all out for you. And again, client contracts, first thing they want to see. If you say, I got a contract with Microsoft, well, I would like to see it. Because if you can't produce that super quick and it's not signed, then you don't have a contract with Microsoft. So investors are used to hearing lots of stories. So make sure that you've got all that in there. Okay, so final thoughts. When you're building a company from day one, think about the exit. Think about everything I just said. They're going to come in and look at all this stuff. Is it all in one place? Is it organized? Do not keep things that could concern people in your due diligence room. So angry letters from clients who didn't like your product, not a good thing to keep in there. Let them find that. Do spend a little bit of time and money up front. So like I said, get into a relationship with a lawyer. Make sure that you're outsourcing or handling your finance. I know Salesforce and NetSuite and places like that can be expensive, but you know, look and see. Don't buy so many seats to the software. Think about how you can do it, but start doing that day one. Be honest during the deal. I see that all the time. People make up stuff. It's not true. They will find it out. The way they do due diligence, they'll talk to your neighbors on the street. They'll figure out. They look at LinkedIn and see, who do I know who knows you? And I will call them. So if you say, oh, I'm such an easygoing person, and all your employees hate you, they will find out. So don't lie. Understand your legal obligations. So understand the term sheet. Understand your articles of incorporation. Any obligations you might have to vendors or employees. And I would say meet with an M&A advisor or an investment banker or somebody like that. I'd meet with them at least once a year, maybe every 6 months if you're growing fast. They'll come and meet with you just like everyone else. Drug you in a bottle. They want to be in there. They want you to be tasting what they can do for you. And say to them, what do you think I'm worth now? So they'll do a back of the envelope, you know, how much revenue, how much did you book, how, you know, how much bad debt, what's your margin, whatever your business is, they know the three or four things to ask you. You answer that, and they'll say, look, you know, I think right now we can probably get you probably about $20 million. If you did this and this and this, we could probably get you $80 million. So have those meetings. Again, there's lots of great investment banks that will look at certain sectors or look at certain sizes, so you don't have to go straight to Goldman Sachs. Even Goldman Sachs now is going downstream and looking at smaller companies. So there are a lot of people out there to help you who are smart, who will meet with you and give you free advice. All you have to do is ask them to come in. Be a little bit careful because they do believe that by taking you to lunch that you are going to hire them, you know, to do the deal. So you do want to be clear that you say, well, we meet with three investment banks a year, you know, just to kind of average it out and see what everybody says. And that way they know that there will be a competitive situation. So that kind of brings me to our time.